Welcome, everybody, to this newest episode of Amateur Theory. Today, we have yet another cult classic. We really like these over here. We're talking about the 2009 movie, Jennifer's Body.
And I think this only kind of recently became a cult classic, because when the movie first came out, not many people seemed to like it. And I'm going to blame, I think, most of that on the marketing, I think.
I remember when this came out in theaters.
Yeah, I vaguely remember it too.
Mm-hmm. I remember not being interested in it because of how it was marketed. And the movie we got and the movie that I thought it would be were very different. Like, I was kind of expecting a mediocre kind of raunchy sex comedy. And, I mean, it is comedy, and it does have some
sexy
but,
bits.
Like, that's not really not what really. The movie's about.
No.
It's really not. It's really more like a horror. I mean, it has comedic elements, kind of like a Scream, but, like, it's like a monster film. You know, like the monster comes and kills people. And in that respect, I think it was great, actually. I really liked this movie.
Yeah, no, because when the movie first came out, I think just the whole marketing was like, oh, Megan Fox is in the movie. She's hot. Like, all you horny teenage boys, like, come and see this. And that's not really what the movie is at all. In fact, I'd say at the very, like, core and heart of this movie, it's about a friendship between these two girls. Jennifer, played by Megan Fox, and Needy, that's the name of the other girl, her nickname, played by Amanda Seyfried. See, this is closer to something I'd say, like, even like Heathers or Mean Girls, more than whatever boner comedy that you know, that's disposable.
And I mean, even as a comedy, there was a couple moments that made me laugh. Like, there is a certain amount of camp to this movie, but I found it charming. Like, I generally appreciated it the whole way through. I also remember at the time that Megan Fox, like many stars that are famous for their looks, think like Zac Efron or Justin Bieber, got a lot of hate, just, you know, kind of almost irrational. Just people just hated them to hate them, and there was no real reason behind it. I actually think her acting in this movie was pretty good. Like, performance was pretty compelling. She had a range of emotions, and like she played them all well. So I would say kudos.
Yeah, and because did she get flack for being a bad actor from like the Transformers movie?
Yeah, I think that was
is that where most of it came from? Because I don't care about those movies really. And I don't really remember them that well. But no, like. Yeah, because I kind of remember her having the reputation of being a bad actress, too. But no, she's good in this movie.
Like, yeah, but did this movie tank her career? Like, I actually can't think of a big starring role she's had after this. Like, she kind of just disappeared from relevancy, as far as I am aware.
Yeah. She might be still acting, just maybe not in, like, bigger budget movies. I guess I don't know for sure. I haven't kept up with her. But if this movie did tank her career, that would be a shame.
Yeah.
Because this is actually a good movie, and she's genuinely good in her role in this film as the lead.
All right. So I guess let's briefly go over the plot. The movie is, you know, it's set contemporarily, which kind of say that this movie made me feel really nostalgic. Like, you had all the aughts rock, the flip phones, the emo hair. Like, I totally feel like I was back in high school. like, I actually really, really liked that. It's such a product of its time. But I have fond memories of it, you know, rose-colored glasses and everything, especially now in 2020. You know, the early 2010s or late 2000s doesn't seem like such a bad time, even though that was during, like, the recession and everything, so I guess.
I mean, everything you view through rose-colored glasses is always going to have the flip side to it, the cons that you don't remember anymore.
That's true. But so there is a the movie starts with there's a two girls that are friends. There's the main character who's kind of a nerd a little bit, or like almost like a goody two shoes ish, not like extreme, but like it's taken that she is the less cool friend, and then she has the super popular cheerleader friend, and
yeah.
And the cheerleader friend, you can tell that the friendship is genuine, but the cheerleader friend kind of, I guess, kind of bullies.
She's pushy, kind of.
Yeah. Yeah, nothing like, you know, inherently like putting you down, but just, you know, she likes things her way, we'll say. And so she drags Needy. Jennifer is the popular one, and Needy is the less popular one. Jennifer drags Needy to this rock show, right, which is at some like kind of scummy
it's
bar.
It's at the local bar, because they live in a small town.
Like, yeah.
Devil's Kettle. And the, like, I guess kind of the attraction is it's an indie band from the city coming like all the way out here to this small town to perform, like, you know, in this bar.
Yeah. And so, yeah, so they see this this band play. The Jennifer hints that she's like interested in the lead singer. And she's like attracted to him. And then the entire bar goes up in flames. And so it's a big deal. Both girls get out, and Jennifer kind of shows symptoms of traumatic stress, or like she's in shock or something.
Yeah.
And the lead singer, which has now revealed himself to be kind of an asshole a little bit, like he's
kind of a creep.
Yeah, they had a conversation with his bandmates about how she was a virgin, and like that's
or
like,
how they think
perfect.
She's a virgin, and therefore she's perfect for something.
Right. But it. I think by this point the audience has learned that she is not actually a virgin, which is important later.
Yeah.
So she they take advantage of her kind of like shocked state to get her into their van, and they drive off.
Yeah.
And so Needy goes back home, but then is visited again by Jennifer, who is just covered in blood, and then like vomits some kind of
black liquid,
yeah,
that like shape shifts once it hits the ground. It's
and so the rest of the movie essentially is Needy figuring out that Jennifer has turned into some kind of monster, almost like a vampire, like it feeds on people, and Jennifer finding men to kind of seduce and then eat. And later you find out, and spoilers, you know, because all our podcasts are spoiler casts. But it turns out the reason for this is because the band tried to sacrifice her in an attempt to become famous, sacrifice her to the devil. And they were successful. They did become famous due to the sacrifice, but you're supposed to sacrifice a virgin. And if you don't sacrifice a virgin, then the body becomes corrupted, and that what makes
the
monster.
Yeah, the victim becomes a monster.
Right. And so the movie ends with Jennifer kills Needy's boyfriend, which causes Needy to go to revenge and stab the monster in the heart. Again, some vampire overtones, which kills Jennifer, and Needy is locked up in prison. But then, twist ending, it turns out that if you are attacked by the monster, which Needy was, but don't die, you inherit some of the powers of like the monster without becoming a monster yourself. And she uses those powers to get revenge on the band, give them their knuppets, comeuppance, and just kind of murders them all at the very end. Like I said, I thought it was really good. There was, when I was reading about this afterwards, I guess the director is a very, like, an adamant feminist. And her thinking behind the movie was that she wanted to flip the damsel in distress thing on its head and make it so that the men were the victims, and the both the hero and the villain were women. The band capturing her and putting her in a van, and then, you know, it's sacrificed in the movie, but it's like a kind of a thinly veiled allegory for like sexual assault, which is I think why people didn't like the movie at first, because again the expectation was going to be like a dumb raunchy kind of sex comedy. And so if you read some of their old reviews, they come off so
I went
out
through
of
some
touch.
Of those too.
Yeah, they suddenly said something like, there wasn't enough like sexy parts or something, or like Jennifer's body didn't make this worth watching. Just stuff. And I mean, I don't know how out of context that is. That maybe, or maybe it's totally accurate to what the review was. But it is just kind of shows you the disconnect between how this was marketed and then what the movie was. You know, you kind of have like this, like, it's supposed to be like this feminist kind of thing, and then it's marketed as, you know, sexy.
I think Roger Ebert
boys.
Called it Twilight for boys, even though he gave a positive review to the movie. But I think he kind of missed it too, because he's in his review, I think he said, well, it's a movie about like a cheerleader monster who eats men. It's about as fun as you can get, but there's more subtext to the movie than that. I think, like earlier I said, at its core, it's about the friendship between Jennifer and Needy, because they've like been like best friends since like they were children. You know, there's some flashbacks, but as the movie goes along, like you kind of discover the more like insidious undertones in their friendship. Like, are they really best friends? Like, because, like you said, Jennifer's like sort of like a little pushy towards the beginning, and after she becomes the monster, she becomes even more like overtly.
Yeah, she's always putting Needy down in whatever way she can, like attacking her fashion
to be trying to get under her skin.
Right. And then at the end. Oh, yeah.
And just Needy, like, kind of like lets it all happen, like, goes along with it just because she kind of needs this friendship.
You know, I didn't even catch that, but that's actually like such an obvious. I like that. That's good. I like those little rhetorical. Whatever in movies, but in the end, you know, it's Needy accuses Jennifer of doing this because she's insecure. So it's not that she's just mean for being mean's sake, but there's some kind of insecurity behind the fact that, you know, she's so popular, et cetera, which adds some complexity to the relationship and to their the dynamic, which was all, you know, I think everyone has had a situation of a relationship or friendship that, you know, was you've had for a long time, but maybe there's some toxic elements, and that doesn't necessarily mean you need to stab them in the heart like that happened in this movie. But you know, it's navigating through those murky waters. It's not quite a black and white relationship. You know, shades of gray, which I think makes for a compelling storytelling because it feels more real.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, I guess you could stab them in the heart in the end if you really want, or no, if they kill your significant other, then you get permission. Stab them in the heart.
And even when she killed, so instead, usually like with the, you kill the monster, everyone's just happy, but she stabs Jennifer in the heart, and then her mom walks in, Jennifer's mom, and just sobs uncontrollably because her daughter just died, and you just leave on that. Like, it's not, and I guess like the real villains were the band, right? For doing they show the sacrifice, and I mean, they tie Jennifer up to like a rock and they stab her a bunch of times, you know. Yeah. They no remorse.
No, they're singing the Tommy Two Tone song while they're brutally murdering her.
Yeah, and the very end, you kind of see flashbacks of their and then it's an added thing to the movie that the reason they became famous was because they were viewed as heroes from the fire. So all they did was, first of all, I guess because their equipment started the fire in the first place. And then once everyone left the fire, they took advantage and kidnapped a girl and killed her. But everyone was, I guess it came out as a rumor that they were saving people. They were going into this building. And so the whole town just loved this band. They're just like worshiping them. And that's what made them famous. So it's like a, it does a really good job of making you, you know, hate the villain. Or like wanted to see them.
They say like one of their songs, they'll send like 3% of the royalties.
Oh yeah,
like to the victims, of the families of the fire. And Needy just goes like, "Oh, what about the other 97%?"
So yeah, the entire time, I actually thought Jennifer was gonna be the one to kill them, and I was actually waiting for that moment. Like I was ready to see those guys get what's coming to them. But then, you know, it pays off in the end, so it's good. And I always like that when the villain is sympathetic. Like, I appreciate that a lot in movies. when it's not just a, you know, a,
yeah, when it's not so black and white.
Right. And like I said, the band are kind of more of a black and white cartoony kind of villain, but they're really not a big part of the movie. You know, they're at the beginning, they're at the end. And so, like, I'll give them a pass. It's okay.
Yeah.
What did you think of the soundtrack of all the art rock? I mean, they gave a pretty good mix. You had indie, you had like the emo stuff, you know, some like pop punk.
There was some metal thrown in there.
There was. And actually, funny enough, I remember the one of the songs is by a band called The Sword. And it was like one of the more metal-y tracks. And I remember that because back when the movie came out, I don't remember how I might have been like a free iTunes single or something. But like I got that song and it was from Jennifer's Body soundtrack. And so it played in this movie and I was like, oh my God, I remember this from like over a decade ago.
One of the free iTunes singles that I think we both got was I'm Not Gonna Teach Your Boyfriend How to Dance with You. And that
I didn't even know that was from this movie, but like that was also cool. I was like, I remember this.
And I mean, like, well, the movie's named after a Hole song, which, and then they do play a Hole song at the end of the movie, but it's not Jennifer's Body, it's Violet. I can understand the soundtrack having a nostalgic, you know, having a you know, what, it can make you nostalgic.
Yeah.
If, like, assuming, like, you grew up around then. And I guess we both did. I think you were more into some of this music than I was.
Well, you're just really into the classics, classic rock. So, that's yeah. Especially at this time. At that time when this music was popular.
I was listening to a fair amount of indie stuff, I think.
But, yeah, it was... and, like I said, they really ham up the... I could talk about MySpace. And they use certain I don't even know what you call it, computer lingo.
MoveOn.org.
The way they talk. Okay.
The slang in this movie is. I started, I think, writing down some of the words when I got through the halfway point.
Did you? Because I would actually like to hear it. Because I really appreciated it the whole way through. I was like, I love what they're doing.
Or just things I noticed. Okay, well. Yeah. The one I like the most is salty, because people use the word salty nowadays, but in a very different fashion.
Right.
Because in the movie, it means like someone's like super hot or something. It's like, oh, yeah. He's so salty. And it just puts an image of a guy in my mind just like brooding in the corner with like a big frowny face. Like, just so I'm going like, oh, he's so salty. But yeah, salty in this movie means beautiful. Someone tells Needy she's lesb-gay for Jennifer.
Oh,
not just
yeah,
like,
or something like
lesbian
that.
Or you're in love with her. You're lesb-gay. Never heard that. I got a freak-tarded.
You can tell that this was before some of these are the lesser PC terms. They're over a decade old.
Jennifer tells one of the boys she's trying to seduce, like, you're giving me such a wetty.
Oh. It was things like that, honestly, that were most of the laughs came from, at least for me. Like, when I was just hearing them talk.
I liked them enough to write some of them down. Yeah.
They were pretty good.
Yeah. Which isn't to say, like, some of the slang's weird, but I think the dialogue in this movie is actually pretty good. Like, it's good at capturing, like, teenagers, I suppose.
No, they totally, the characters felt real. Like, that was the biggest thing. Like, the characters were fleshed out, like, they all had very distinct personalities. And then they acted to other characters in a way that made sense for their character. Which, you know, sounds like should be just so basic, all movies should do this, but... It's actually rarer than you'd think.
No, I mean, how many horror movies have you seen with teenagers that are just caricatures?
Yeah.
It's like, oh, all these people are just, like, douchebags. Like, they're just... Their assholeness is, like, cranked up to, like, 10. And then, like, you just want them to die. And that's the movie.
And I think this movie even kind of played up the stereotypes. Because in this movie, you had, you know, the popular cheerleader which we already talked about how it gets some depth. And then, you know, there was the first guy to get eaten, or the first guy we saw on screen get eaten, was kind of like the dumb jock guy.
Yeah, but he's like...
He's broken up because his friend died.
Yeah, he's mourning because his friend died in the fire. Like, he's not like some, like, insensitive asshole. Like, no, he's actually broken up. Like, wow. Wow. The writing. Oh, my God.
And, I mean, I guess I want to... Because I think we have a habit of doing this on this podcast. Because we watch so many bad movies that when something is, like, good, we, like, heap praise on it. I don't know if you feel this way. I wouldn't say this is like the greatest movie of all time.
No, like this is not
like amazing,
movie.
But it's solid. Like, it is a solidly good movie and underrated.
Yeah, well, yeah, I think just part of our praise comes from the fact that this movie just was so badly received for a while, and it's like, no, it's really not. It's not bad.
Yeah.
Like, it's a pretty good movie.
If anyone knows badly received movies, it's us. And this one doesn't deserve it. This one doesn't deserve it.
No, yeah. And, like, it's not perfect. Like, there are definitely flaws, like, I found with, like, some of, like, the screenplay. But it's, for what it is, it's really actually well done. Like, I think it's written well. The direction is solid. The acting from, like, pretty much everyone around is good.
What did you think of the monster scenes, like the actual, I appreciated how gory it let itself get. Like, actually,
it was
satisfying.
You don't see too much of the violence, like, firsthand. A lot of it's like, well, the first person, it's the aftermath, but you do see like their like stomachs like ripped open and like guts are hanging out.
And they use language, like they'll talk about it afterwards. Because they'll say,
yeah,
like,
they describe
him? He looks like lasagna.
Yeah, lasagna with teeth. That's what one of the dead bodies looks like.
And I think it's actually pretty effective, given that, it's like a thing in horror that everything you can see, as soon as you can see it, it becomes less scary. So, like, having things... Not that this movie is very scary. Like, I didn't... that wasn't really scary at any point. There was a couple moments that were maybe a little tense-ish. Did you catch the one guy, Needy got like a car ride from an actor, and he's the lead guy from Pumpkinhead. Am I saying that name?
Oh, crap! He's in Aliens. What's his name?
Lance. Yeah, Henderson. He's in a bunch of horror movies. He's like a horror movie veteran. It was just a little cameo.
I totally forgot about that, actually. Yeah, Lance Henriksen shows up at the end.
Very small role, but it was cool. It was like, oh, look at that. I wonder if... I don't know if this director went on to do anything else in, like, the public eye.
Yeah, well, the writer for the movie had written Juno before this.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and Juno gotten a lot of buzz when it came out, and I think it's like, now she... Yeah, Diablo Cody, I think that's her name. And then, like, it's like, oh, she's writing a horror movie now. Like, and then just the marketing department completely failed on every aspect. And since then, I don't know what she's done. I haven't looked it up. But, I don't know. Juno and this, she's a good screenwriter. I hope she's still getting work.
Do you think that if this movie had been marketed better, it would have done well? Because one thing I noticed that was kind of a criticism of one or an explanation of why it didn't succeed was because this is such a like it's such so gory and like it's a hard R, right? Not necessarily for being like nudity or things, but hard R for the violence, especially and some of the language. This is a high school movie. Like it seems like the primary audience for this would be teenagers who, you know, can't go see the movie without having their parents come with them or something. And do you want to bring your parents to Jennifer's body? I don't know.
I don't know if that's really stopped that many people before. You have classics like what? Like The Breakfast Club? That's R.
True. But it might be, and I guess maybe the marketing would play into this, but it is a thing of what kind of movies do you want to watch with your parents? You know, Breakfast Club doesn't sound so bad. but Jennifer's body might not be something you want to ask your parents to go see with you, right? You know, that's something you'd want to see on your own. And so if you're a high schooler, then you're just kind of out of luck in a lot of ways.
Possibly. I guess, yeah, I don't know the numbers on that or whatever. Like, but I don't know. I just feel like, because I remember being in high school, and I feel like people somehow managed to see, like, new R-rated films in theaters all the time. So you find... You become friends with the one person who has a parent that just doesn't care. and he'll just take kids to see anything.
Yeah, and if it was marketed as like a straight up like a horror thing more than like a sex comedy, there might have been less hesitation to, you know, have that conversation anyway. You know, can I see the new horror movie? One thing, can we talk about how we watched the unrated version?
Yeah. Well, I've seen the unrated version and the original theatrical version.
Did you?
So I can. Yeah.
Okay. So I heard that there's not actually that much difference at all, but I guess you'd know better.
No. No, because I saw the theatrical version first, and then I saw the unrated, and I think there's like maybe one or two moments where I'm like, I think they added some like dialogue here or added. But that's like it. Like
that's
there was
when you think of unrated, like, oh, we're gonna get some like crazy, you know, violent sex language or something that wasn't. But like that's not what it is.
That's just what happened in the late 2000s. Like every movie like got the unrated version, and it was always like I think changes usually were like just minimal, like blink and you'll miss it type of thing. It was another marketing thing. Like oh. The unrated version. It's like
it was actually funny. I saw this on Available to Rent, and the original version was like able to rent for five. This was on Amazon, I think. It was like $5 or something cheap, and then the unrated version was like $15.
What?
So, or something outrageous. I don't remember exactly the pricing, but it was. I remember the unrated version being like at a premium. And then being like, oh, no.
It really doesn't make much of a difference.
Yeah. So if you're picking it up and you see there's a price difference, just get the cheaper one. It doesn't.
Yeah.
How do you think that this is, would you classify this more as a horror movie or more as a comedy? Or maybe something different entirely?
And just like a horror, because you have horror comedies. I mean, you have stuff like Brain Dead. I don't know why that's the example I came up with. I could probably think of something more famous than that. But just stuff that's like deals with horrific elements, but you know, just has a general aura of like levity somewhat to it.
But I mean, like, there are some movies that kind of might fit that description, but go one direction or the other. Like, I would say that Scream, you know, often is labeled as a core horror comedy, but it's much less heavy in the comedic department, I think. And it's more of a horror film with maybe a little comedic elements compared to, like, Scary Movie, which is heavy on the comedic elements and light on the horror, just as, you know, two extremes. So do you think this is, like, right down the middle? Or is it, you know... lean one direction more than the other?
For me, I think I'd say it's actually pretty close to the middle. If I... Yeah, actually, no. To me, it's...
I actually might agree, because it's... Yeah. Like I said, it's not scary per se, but it's certainly... Like, it's got... It's, like I said, it's plenty of gore, lots of murder and everything with the... And, you know, there's the monster. She has, like, her face, like, opens up when she's about to kill someone. And, like...
Yeah, she's got, like, these, like, demonic, like, sharp teeth.
Yeah, so there's plenty of that. But then this movie is just so, like...
I mean, it's kind of, like, wink-wink, too. Like,
yeah.
I think Needy, she finds out about what Jennifer is. She's like, oh, I went to the occult section in our school library.
Right. And the guy was like, the occult section? She's like, it was small.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's just moments.
So the movie is self-aware in that sense.
Yeah. Who do you think you could maybe recommend this to? Would you just recommend this to any horror fan, or would it could anybody watch this, or do you need to be?
Yeah, I'd say. If you're into like cult classic horror stuff, then yeah, definitely check this one out. I don't know, even as a high school movie, because I think earlier I compared it to like Heathers or like Mean Girls. Like, it kind of falls along that sort of vein too. So
yeah, especially Heather, because you know you got all the killings and the, you know, there's the. So it's, I think there's a lot of parallels there. I think I would agree. I think that most people, if you're, you know, not opposed to gore, if gore turns you off, you probably wouldn't like this movie. But otherwise, I would say give it a watch. Just don't expect a raunchy sex comedy. You know, just know what you're getting into ahead of time. And
it's not that sexy of a movie. This isn't Showgirls.
Yeah. But I guess we can leave it at that. Definitely, we're gonna recommend this one. I'm gonna give one of my infamous scores, off the cuff scores.
Oh, okay.
Give it a 7.5 out of what?
We're getting into decimals.
Who knows? I don't know. But anyway, thank you for watching. You know, if you're on YouTube, give us a like, give subscribe. If you're watching us on Google Podcast, Spotify, give us a follow. And until next time.
Until next time.